What's going on, all of my healthcare providers? I hope that you are having a wonderful day. Today, we're continuing on with the ACLS Megacode scenario videos, and we're going to be looking at respiratory arrest. Let's get started. Let's begin with our patient scenario. You're a healthcare provider caring for a patient who's returned from a surgical procedure. What is your initial impression going to look like? Well, when you look at the patient is a man returning from recovery from a cholecystectomy. The PACU was experiencing overflow, so he had returned to the surgical unit for post-surgical recovery. I'm going to be honest with you, if you're working on a surgical unit, this is probably going to happen to you a lot. Before surgery, he was a healthy and active father. As you're sitting on the nurse's station, the next thing you know, the wife is running out of the room screaming that her husband is not breathing. When you enter the room, you note that the patient is not responsive. If you haven't done so already, you're going to connect this patient to the monitor. When you connect them, you're going to see that the heart rate is 116 per minute, the blood pressure is 120 over 60, respiratory rate is 2 per minute, the SpO2 is unknown, the temperature is also unknown, and the patient is 34. What is going to be your initial actions? Well, looking based on the scenario, we have a high heart rate, our blood pressure is still okay, but our respiratory rate is 2. Right? So as we know, the body is just in a constant form of compensation. So when one system starts to fail, other systems are going to pick up. So when our respiratory system fails, we're only breathing 2 per minute, we're not perfusing that oxygen down into our lungs to attach to the hemoglobin as well as exhale that carbon dioxide that the hemoglobin picked up from the tissues. So what the heart will do is the heart is going to pump faster because it wants to get that remaining oxygen that's left into that hemoglobin to its vital life-saving organs. So that's why when we've got these low respiratory rates, you're going to see this increase in these heart rates. Because as we know, this gentleman was an active father, right? And he was very healthy. So a heart rate of 116 is probably going to be very high for him. So initial actions, let's take a look at them. So initially, what we're going to want to do is do our BLS assessment as well as intervention. So we want to check for responsiveness. You're going to tap and shout, "Are you okay?" And I'm not talking about this little tap, "Are you okay?" I want you to, "Are you okay?" You want to see if you can get this patient up, right? If the patient is still unresponsive and doesn't hear you, like in this particular situation, we're going to activate the emergency response system. What does that look like? Well, we're going to shout for help and we're going to start getting the code cart ready with the AED. As we know right now, the patient still has a pulse and still has a heart rate. So just in case things go bad, we want to make sure we have that equipment at the bedside. We're going to check for breathing, and that's usually we're scanning the chest for about 5 to 10 seconds. As you scan the chest, you're going to notice that the patient appears to be breathing 2 per minute. So we know that that is at very abnormal. So we're going to next check for a pulse. We're going to scan for a pulse for about 5 to 10 seconds. And I'm going to be honest with you, when you're scanning for breathing as well as a pulse, you're really doing those things simultaneously. You don't want to wait for 20 seconds before you start actually performing interventions. So breathing, like I said, breathing and pulse is checked simultaneously. And then if we are unable to find a pulse, we're going to start chest compressions. But we know in this case, it's not necessary because there is a pulse present. So the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to attach an AED. So as we know, based on the scenario, this is really a breathing issue. So we want to immediately insert some kind of oropharyngeal or nasopharyngeal airway and begin administering oxygen. We do this by performing effective bag mask ventilation for at least 1 minute. We're going to give proper ventilation rates once every 6 seconds. We're going to give proper ventilation speed over 1 second, and we're going to provide proper ventilation volume. That's about half the bag. You don't need to compress the entire bag. Just half will give them enough of a breath. Once we connect the patient to the monitor, we're going to see this rhythm. What is this rhythm? This is a narrow complex tachycardia. So what's some important additional information that we need to know? Well, the patient was symptom-free the previous day. So this is something very acute, right? The patient was rushed to surgery for an emergency cholecystectomy. And the wife notes that he has no health problems that she knows of and has never had surgery. So this is a very acute issue that's most likely related to the surgery. So what do you think happened to this patient? Well, most likely what happened was respiratory arrest secondary to surgical anesthesia. So how much anesthesia did the patient get? Did we, as healthcare providers, give narcotics for pain after the surgery maybe too soon? And did we give too much narcotics? Those are all things that can really inhibit the respiratory system. Should we have placed this patient on an end-tidal capnography machine as soon as they arrived to the floor? Because as we know, CO2 changes are going to occur before we see any changes in SpO2. So was there a potential that we could have caught this problem earlier? Most likely, absolutely. I highly recommend, this is just going off script when it comes to the Acls Megacode scenario, is that if you are working in a post-surgical unit, that you are monitoring these patients, especially if they didn't spend much time in the PACU, for their end-tidal CO2. Because that those CO2 changes are going to occur much faster, and you're going to catch this problem much quicker. And this patient probably could have been, he was saved, obviously, we saved him, but we could have addressed it much faster so that hopefully there's no neurological damage depending on how long he was breathing at that 2 per minute. I hope that this video was helpful in understanding what to do in this ACLS Megacode scenario. If you have any additional questions, make sure that you leave them down below. I love answering your questions. Make sure you follow me on my social media. I'm on Facebook as well as Instagram. If you're not already, subscribe here on YouTube and make sure you turn on that bell notification so you're notified every time I post a new video. If you haven't done so already, make sure that you check out my website at www.nursechung.com, where there's additional resources on the ACLS algorithms as well as scenarios. But until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I will see you all again soon. Bye.